Well, the Artie Quitter podcast. Of course, Mara Cantone is here.
Don't start with me, Artie, all right?
I'm just doing it. You know what? I mixed up Mario's who like dick in my head. I'm sorry. Cantone, Batali. Kidding. Very kidding. There's no way Batali's gay. He's very manly. I roasted him once. Yeah, I was wearing orange clogs with a tuxedo.
Mario Batali?
Yeah.
To match his hair?
Exactly. Well, that's what we roasted him. And, that, you know, orange clogs with a tuxedo, that's not a fucking volleyball coming in.
That's his look.
Is that his look?
Does he get a piece of the clog money?
I bet he does.
He's got to.
He's got to. But with orange, though? Does he have to wear orange clogs?
That's his thing. He always wears orange ones. I don't think he ever... Isn't it? Damn.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know.
Dan, do you know that? When he was wearing a Batali, he introduced me to a lot Italy. Fucking 80 bucks.
I don't know if he wears only orange ones. I don't know.
80 bucks for a fucking mozzarella sandwich. At La Italy. They see us coming.
Fucking amazing restaurants, though.
Well, I know, but Dan's a Chicago Italian, so he was all impressed by it. Oh, my God. You've got to see a Batali's Italian piece.
We were in the neighborhood.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Did they got Italian? Did you have the bread over there? Yeah, it's called bread. Yeah. I better bread fucking 2 feet from my house growing up.
You've been to Terry Lodge by Mario Batali?
What's that?
He owns a bunch of restaurants up in my area called Terry Lodge.
What's your area? Oh, Tarrytown.
There's one, not Tarrytown. He owns one in Porchester,
but
one
it's Terry
in Stamford,
Lodge,
Connecticut.
Terry Lodge is about Tarrytown, right? Is that why it's called that?
No, I don't know. And he has like one of those Italian like markets next to it.
Well, that's what Italy is in Manhattan. And when Nick and I started the Nick and Artie show, Dan produced it. Actually, Dan was very generous. He bought us lunch and... Another great mix story.
What happened?
No, at the end, Dan bought us lunch every day, and it was very helpful because we had to get there early to try to figure the show out and, settle into a groove, is what I was told by Ken Cole, the middle manager guy. Artie, Ken Cole. Listen, he's a classic, like, middle management radio sycophant who just, anybody above him, you could change his mind just by saying the different thing. Like, you know, listen, it's a beautiful day. It's raining. It's raining. Of course it's raining.
That's me. I'm that way.
You are? No.
Yeah,
not like this. You are?
If I'm asking advice on something.
I'm like that with a woman. Eventually I just give up. if they ask a question, I go, let's go with your opinion. So we can get the fuck to your brother's house for a birthday party. What?
Mario Batali ordered 200 pairs of orange, how do you say it?
Orange Crocs.
Crocs. And Crocs.
Mary, you realize we're on the air, Mary, right?
I understand, but I'm reading.
Nobody asked you to read anything.
He came out with his own Crocs of orange. Orange Crocs.
They're his. That's
orange
he
Crocs.
Coined the
he
color.
Coined, he coined the color.
So, yeah, so he gets a little piece.
Same color as his hair.
Is he donating that money to anything positive?
It doesn't say
he's keeping that fucking money.
Look, the markup on a mozzarella sandwich in Italy. The guy's got to have a fucking yacht.
I actually prefer when famous people just keep all their money.
Yeah, me too. Keep it. It's weird, right?
You should donate it. They forced like Michael Jordan to donate a bunch of money.
Well, he donated a bunch of money to his ex-wife.
But does he deserve that money? That it's just because he decided Mario Batali. I mean, he didn't come up with
this. This is America. It's capitalism. If you can make it, I love money.
He didn't
come
up with the color orange.
Well, that's true. What is he called? Did he come up with a name for the color, like a new name?
You can't walk into a kitchen anywhere in America now without seeing a cook wearing Crocs. They all fucking wear them.
But Luigi has worn Crocs for 20 years.
No one knows Luigi. No one knows
Luigi.
Really?
Yeah.
So he's been. So Mario wasn't the first guy.
No, he was not. No.
So he doesn't deserve that money.
Explain
for his
to Luigi.
Orange ones.
I know,
are great shoes to spill fucking olive oil.
Well, is that why? Because the material. Yeah. Because I used to work with.
I feel like you would slide in them though.
No, well, they got the bottom. They got a grip on them.
No, they're very. I have a pair of them.
Is that what you do at home?
I get made fun of.
Over yourself.
Every guy makes
wait
fun
a minute,
of you.
Wait
if
a minute.
You show
wait
up
a
Crocs.
Minute. Wait a
Here
minute.
Here it comes.
You have a pair of Crocs.
Oh. I do. I have
a pair.
I beg
you to wear them.
I've had them for about 4 years.
I beg you to wear them to the Comedy Cellar.
<They're>,
Actually, nothing will happen because the new Comedy Cellar is nobody makes fun of anybody.
You know, I think everybody,
it's a safe place.
I wore them on stage once because I broke my toe and I couldn't get a shoe on, so I put the Crocs on.
Did you address them?
Yes, they're so bad. Yeah. They're the most unmasculine shoe ever made.
But they're
Well, Chef made it.
Yeah, Mario Batali.
Is he gay?
My Crocs.
No, he's not gay, but I don't know.
He He has to be gay to wear Crocs.
Well, that's very close-minded, Mario. That's very Bensoners of you. So Mario, what's your name? Bosco? Bosco?
Yeah.
Joe Matarese, Adrian Iapucci. It's all Italian.
Nice. We did it.
Hey, jerk off.
What about Dan Filato? He's Italian, but he's from Chicago. That's
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 You have any more updates on how you invented Crocs?
No, the Croc story's over. We put it away.
So now, I heard you had an Olympic update.
Well, USA is winning by 22 medals, and I just received this says that police sets to investigate shooting on media bus traveling between venues at the Olympics game. Bus was traveling between the Rodian Zone and the main transport mall. 12 people were on board when the bullets were launched at the bus. Minor injuries sustained.
Mario, can I ask you something? Did you go to grammar school?
I think he's in grammar school right now.
You know, but did you go to school?
He's in grammar school.
Did you learn how to read?
Yeah, I'm reading right now.
Yeah, but you read like a... You're not
how big that font is.
You're not retarded, right?
Half.
No. You're an intelligent person. Why are you reading like you're in the first grade?
What did I say? Police says to investigate shooting on...
Now you're reading faster. Before you're reading like a, you know...
Media bus traveling between venues at the Olympic Games. Bus was traveling between the deodorant zone and
This is the worst thing ever. It's the worst thing ever. Stop talking.
Did people die?
Most boring thing I've ever heard about.
No, nobody cares. Many injuries sustained.
Who gives a shit?
He's too articulate for this day.
Sheds of glass, but nothing.
Mario, if you don't stop talking, I'm going to ask you to leave.
Well, he's definitely not gay because he's avoiding the fucking microphone. Like it's.
Who's getting that gay?
He talks.
You're definitely not gay because you're like 9 feet away from the mic when you're doing a news update.
You think gay means he wants to suck the mic over there?
No, I'm saying he was like.
I didn't get why is that gay?
Like if I said he's definitely not gay,
right?
Because he's
why is that not gay?
Because it looks like a dick. The mic.
Well, so what I just said.
Avoiding it. Yeah.
Well, like she's not avoiding it. This chick with her. Who's that? Is that Selena Gomez?
No, that's what's that girl's name?
Man, that's a good-looking Spanish chick.
That's that huge girl, Adriana Grande. Is that it?
Oh, Grande.
Grande, yeah.
She was
It's Jim Gaffigan's commercial.
Nice.
And, there's his wife.
Is that his actual wife?
It's good to see him with his wife. They never see each other.
Is that his actual wife?
I don't know how Gaffigan does it. I don't know how Gaffigan does it. She's a lovely woman, his wife, but he, I don't know how he does it. They write that show together. You know, you have to be together with a person. Write 13 episodes of a show. You got to be together all the time. They have 5 children.
I've been in a shitty mood for 2 straight days, and I'm in a better mood right now because
why in a bad mood?
I was just talking to Adrian about it. I actually don't know. I've been fucking just.
You're taking your Adderall, right?
Yeah.
Well, if you're in a bad mood on Adderall, it's a bad sign. Like, you're starting to be used to it. You're used to the dosage.
Yeah, I guess.
You should start snorting it.
I've just been pissed off.
This is the level when you start snorting it.
It's about 6 things combined.
What's the matter? Can you say it?
Yeah. Okay, I'll answer all of it.
Well, go ahead.
Money is on the list.
Yeah, it's always on the list, man. Everybody, well, unless you're Tom Hanks. Looking at Tom Hanks, you probably have money problems. But there's money problems. There's money problems. Like how bad? Like you know.
I don't know.
Like losing a house, money problems, or you know.
No, but I start to think like could the career, Adrian
like starting
and I,
to
like,
sell real estate?
Like it could be over. Like that feeling. You're like what
you're
the
gonna
fuck?
Start DJing.
That's very sad because I gotta say you know, and I'm not just saying this.
DJ.
I'm not just saying this because you know Joe, my buddy, is here, but that is sad because you know Joe is a. Great comic, you know, like a really talented guy, like just a pro, can handle any situation. You know, he's a good writer, you know, I've always admired his ability to do stand up for 20 years. I think he's great.
Well, because
that doesn't clearly doesn't mean right. Shit.
No, it doesn't.
No.
And because of that, it's hard to go. Okay, let me try to focus on, like.
Right, exactly. You say to yourself, I'm good at it. Why leave?
Well,
right?
Well, Mario, you made that observation. What did your mom always say to you?
If you get off the line, somebody else behind you is going to take your spot. So if you stop doing comedy, the guy behind you could be me jumping in your spot, taking your comedy.
See, but Mario, here's the thing. Here's the difference between you and Joe. You're hard.
Well, Mario's not going to take
you're not
spots.
Funny at all.
Why am I not funny? I had good jokes.
I don't know.
Let's not start up your fucking road manager, okay?
Well, yeah, he's one problem. Okay, but you have to focus problem. On... Have you thought of any other careers?
No.
All right, well, that's a problem.
What about professional gambler? Book?
Do you consider yourself funny like that's what you do, or you're an actor?
Well, I like to get into stand-up comedy. I feel like I could tell people my life in... comedy.
Can I give you my opinion on that?
You could probably do TED Talks, though, and make a lot of money.
Well, that's the thing. Probably here's the thing.
You could be a little
Adrian,
funny
Adrian is
that.
Also a very smart, funny comic, and I would assume broke.
Yeah.
So, Mario, you have a shot. Because you're not good, and you know, that is rewarded.
But you know what? If I have good writers that write me good material.
Who has writers? What are you, Bob Hope? What are you going to pay writers to write you good material? And all of a sudden, Larry Gelbart. And,
No, I mean, I had good jokes.
Who's going to write for you?
Joe Mary.
First of all, your mother's advice was don't get off the line. What?
Meaning that if you're going.
I get the
message. Don't get jumped out because somebody's going to take
you. Yeah, I get. So that seems like a very easy thing to figure out. You have to go to Tibetan monk for.
And I just started out as a comic.
Do not. Well, you're 58.
I'm 43.
Well, how come you didn't start off? You know, why didn't you start younger?
Because I never met you younger.
Me? You mad at me to be a stand-up comic?
Well, I'm an apprenter. So I'm imprinting off of you.
What the fuck is he talking about?
What's an imprint?
Apprentice?
It's a way to apprentice? Say, it's a pensioner's way to say apprentice.
Yeah.
Apprentice.
I'm an apprentice. You know what I'm saying?
Apprentice off of you.
Yeah. So. Well, you could be a printer. What about that?
No, I don't want to be a printer.
But let's get back on the more serious subject because, you know, is Joe, how serious is that thought of quitting?
And no, what, no, no,
and
no,
what
no,
would
no.
you do?
I didn't think about quitting.
But what would you do if that's an... Because I think of this often. Well, I'd have to load trucks.
No, we've talked about this on your podcast
nothing else
before.
I do.
But I
not
mean,
in depth.
I think this is the problem with what you said, like... I don't want people to think like, oh yeah, I'm making no money, but I don't think you get into stand-up comedy.
How much are you making?
But we don't get into this career to go, oh, I want to make an okay living. Like you want to fucking crush it.
Absolutely.
Like that's what you want.
Well, you should because if you try to crush it, you land somewhere else and you're happy with it.
Yeah, it's like when I compare it to sports. I was very that's how I was. I was competitive when I played sports. Like I got pissed off at my son this past weekend, fucking playoff game. I don't care that he's 8.
Yeah.
He showed up in a bad mood. We didn't even get to the field yet.
Which
I go, what the fuck are you doing? I'm playing him Herb Brooks speeches on the phone.
The guy, the hockey coach of the 80.
Yeah, team. The coach of the 80 Olympic hockey team because they played they were playing the Russians when my son, I call him my brother because my brother's younger. I always confuse it with my son.
Right.
Now, my son was playing against...
By the way, that's not a good explanation.
It's a weird slip. Well, my brother's 9 years younger for some reason.
Oh, you think it was okay.
He was a baby when I was like 12, and now I mix it up somehow.
Okay.
So mine, I never mix it up.
Yeah, I'm weird.
I think that's a bigger issue than the
I'm an
money.
Idiot. Now, my son was playing this team that beat them earlier in the season.
A lot of
like
blacks on the team?
14-0. No. Right. That was amazing.
That's crazy.
So my son was completely psyched out on the fucking way there, and I was just pissed and then just was moping around the whole game.
Psyched out?
Like,
what do you mean? About losing?
No, even before he got there, like, we're going to lose, and then he struck out his first time up, and his mind was...
You're exactly
out of the game.
The same way.
Yeah. Well, how old is he?
Do I do that?
This is going to be awful.
Yeah.
But I'll try.
How old is your son?
He's 8, going on 9.
It's Adderall time.
It is. Well,
no, do not. I'm kidding. No. Give the kid meth.
I actually think that has something to do with it, believe it or not.
What?
He was taking medication during the school year for attention deficit, but not an amphetamine version. Non-amphetamine version.
I mean,
was helping, and then he went off it, and I swear to God, I saw his batting average go down.
Joe, don't do that to your kid. Don't never give him another pill like that. Honestly, as an addict, I know he's crashing from the medication. Do you know what that's like?
He's been off it for months. Yeah, he's not still crashing.
No, yeah, he is. It could take years. mentally. You get depressed.
Was that why I'm depressed?
Well, are you just taking less Adderall?
No, it's the same. I take the same.
Well, you could be used to the dosage and you're not getting the effect.
Do you feel more productive on Adderall?
Listen, again, Joe was not a drug addict when he was younger. I was. We used to talk about focus. We used to do blow or take methamphetamine. We used to take those speed, those black beauties, the goofballs they called them. And
goofballs.
We would take out my buddy's transmission in his Camaro, make it a stick shift. Then we'd put it back. We'd make it an automatic. Make it a stick shift. That's what we did all weekend.
That's the whole week.
We focused on that. Nothing but that. And
well, I've already had your Twitter followers say, please don't talk about Adderall and your meds on the Artie Lang, Artie Quitter podcast.
No. Let me tell you something. In the beginning, it's euphoric. It really is. Did you have a feeling of euphoria on it in the very beginning?
No, I still have this is where I can see and understand how addicts work, because you can get used to denying yourself sleep if you know you have the Adderall the next morning to pick you back
up. It's something to look forward to. In other words, it's like Santa Claus coming.
Yeah, you're like, who cares if I get 4 hours sleep? I'll drink a cup of coffee and take an Adderall in the morning.
To me, an addict thinks like they constantly have to have something to look forward to. If it's not a high, it's sex, it's gambling, mm-hmm. it's whatever. And if you don't have anything to look forward to in your head, you get very depressed. That's the mental part. Wow, then there's a physical part of, I can't believe this country, there's doctors who are okay, even a non amphetamine version, giving an 8-year-old anything that alters their mood that way. That's one day we're going to look back on this and go, this is the craziest time ever. Are coming, like this person I know, who I used to be very close with, who may or may not have the same name as someone in this room. You know, they were 14 years old. They come back. They're getting straight A's in everything, okay? And except history class, they're getting a C. Now, mommy and daddy would never think that their precious child would get a C in anything. There's got to be something wrong that's outside your intelligence. And they find out, she goes, well, what do you do in the class? She goes, well, sometimes I look out the window and I don't really pay attention. Oh, well, you have attention, you have ADD. So a doctor wants to make money, gives this 14-year-old Adderall, which is methamphetamines. She finds she could do, she takes tests, but everything's perfect, you know, straight A's. But what happens is she crashes. So how do they deal with the crash? Xanax. So at 14, you're basically speedballing these kids. And in rich communities, that's what these kids do. The doctors become their pusher. You know,
no good.
By the time they're 28, they're dating me.
Oh, shit.
You got to be careful.
Well, here's the second part of the bad mood. And I'm curious, because this is what's weird. Your name came up. At a store today.
Right.
And I'm like, this is very odd. I also find that I become very hyper-focused, very OCD-like when it comes to projects in my house. Now, we're doing this cheap version of fixing our kitchen, and I was at some place in Mount Vernon today buying a faucet.
Right.
And I'm like trying to pick out the faucets, and I hear, Artie Lang? Artie Lang. And Artie, and I heard your name three times. I'm like, what the is Artie Lang a new faucet style? Like, what did you buy a bunch of kitchen shit today? Why did your name come up in Mount Vernon?
Oh, you never figured out why?
No, it was upstairs. I heard it from like the second floor.
Can I tell you something else you might be in denial about? That I'm your good friend and I'm more famous. You don't understand why my name?
I was like, it was weird. It was coincidental that I'm buying like kitchen shit, and then it sounds. I'm like, I guess Artie's buying a kitchen right now.
We have been calling Mario the faucet of boredom.
Speaking of boredom.
No, we said faucet a couple times. Though.
So it wasn't you. There's another Artie Lang.
I was not in Mount Vernon.
You weren't there, I'm saying.
Right.
You were purchasing something, and the employee...
Well, they were yelling out something?
They were saying something like, Artie Lang needs the something. Like, did you have some sort of...
Oh, no.
No, kitchen.
So there was an ogle, I guess, or someone maybe...
There was another Artie Lang, I guess. It was weird. I'm like, Artie Lang.
Right. Well, you know, okay. So what that made you sad?
No. I've been in a bad mood because my wife, I find, is not. I don't think holding up her her level of the marriage here. I'm just like, what the fuck? Why do I have to pick out the faucet? Why do I have to pick out the countertop?
That's what you're upset about? Doesn't she work full time?
Yes, that's what she says. She goes, I don't have time to do it. I'm like, do it on the weekend when I go on the road.
Now we have to stop.
I mean, besides the story being a little boring.
Yeah, it is.
Now you're also
a little. No, now we have to stop. She could argue that the reason you have a faucet is because of it.
What's he saying, Goodfellas? Now I gotta.
Does she make more money than you?
I gotta release you.
Does she make more money than you?
Yeah, she doubles my salary.
Well, how is she not keeping up her end of the
bargain? I mean, I'm
saying, like,
insane.
On the weekend when I'm going on the road,
when you work once a week?
No, shut up. Dude,
twice a week, okay?
You're bringing this up. First of all, Joe, you are so geeked out right now. You know how high you look?
Oh,
you're going like this.
I drank a lot of coffee.
He did.
When's the last time you took an Addy?
3 hours ago.
Dude, you fucking, you're fucking high.
You're high.
You realize you're high right now.
Come on. You have the best life. Like, I look at your life, I'm like, this guy's doing drugs all day. His wife's working. His kids, somebody else is watching. You're doing nothing all day. You're buying one faucet and you're complaining.
No, it wasn't one faucet. It was like nine different things. Well, I just wanted her to go do some of it while I was away
Are you sure my name wasn't in your head?
She said, what kind of faucet do you want? I was like, well, Artie Lang will tell you.
Artie Lang will tell
you. He knows. Call him.
I'm going to say you secretly don't want to kill me, right?
I feel like you're going to hit me. Like, I know you're not going to hit me, but the way you're talking to me, it feels like
Joe, I've known you for how long now? 23 years. You're not the Joe Matarese. You're very high. You're high right now.
Really?
All right. Without question, you're high.
All right.
You're geeking out. You're like, oh, like this. What about getting off the Adderall? That's impossible, right?
How long have you been on Adderall for? I thought you were just on, like, antidepressants.
No, I've been on antidepressants for about 6 years.
On top of the antidepressants.
Adderall about a year.
And you're on the Adderall, too, on top of the antidepressants.
Yes.
What do you take for depression?
Celexa.
I take Lexapro.
Same shit.
Wow, Barrow, great, thank you.
10 milligrams. What do you take?
Half a pill, because the other half makes me tired.
Yeah.
What do you mean the other half makes you tired?
I can't.
Not tired enough, you made it here.
On a full pill.
Tired.
I don't know. I'm a little worried about you.
Yeah, me too.
Because I think you're, like, I watched you on that red eye, and you were high on that thing.
What?
You're going like this. Believe me, I know what it looks like. You're twisting your neck all the time. And
you might be high just that you were watching Red Eye.
Well, no, I mean,
That's not a good sign.
I flipped the channel.
It's on at 3:30 in the morning.
Well, I can't sleep. I've never slept in my life. But I so what else? Is there other reasons? You said there's six reasons. But the money, look, the money's a big deal.
The money, yeah. My wife and I have just been, just fighting, arguing.
You know,
I have a vacation coming up with her entire family.
Right.
Her entire family. Every single year, we almost get divorced on this trip. I swear to God. Like, we just fucking brawl.
I don't know how you could do it.
Just go the full way. Just get divorced. Stop almost getting divorced.
No, but here's the thing. She is a great woman. She's a catch and a half, man.
I know. That's what keeps me in.
Yeah, that's a rare chick you got there, man.
You have a great life.
I have a joke about how you start to get lazy. You ever have a lazy voice in your head? Like, she just starts bitching at me.
That's the only voice.
I'm in my head. In my head, I'm going, just fucking end this shit. This is stupid.
Everything I do, my voice in my head says, just slow down.
Just end it.
Well, you ever work with union guys? Like, I used to work on the construction. They go, what are you breaking a speed record? They're trying to get overtime. Again, Luke is the greatest kid. I think he's the greatest kid, that kid.
Oh,
I really
I've been having the best time with my kids on top
of... So there's a huge positive.
That's a huge positive. My son's been playing travel baseball. It's so fucking fun to go there an hour before the game and pitch to him and get him ready see him succeed. It's awesome.
It sounds like soon you'll have crystal meth in common.
Nah.
If you go down that road.
I already have.
Just
that.
I watched Field of Dreams with my son the other night. It was fucking incredible.
Just don't ever give the kid that pill again.
Yeah, never.
Never?
No, right. No, no, no.
I mean, that would be my advice.
Keep the math score up and the reading level
that's
down.
Why was it? So that's what happened. The reading was bad. But, you know, that's what life is. Like, you know, human beings for some reason are made to be, most people are good at one thing and not good at another. And these parents nowadays want their kid to be good at everything.
Right.
And you're altering their mind to do it. Think about that.
I agree.
What the fuck does that pill do to your mind where it can make you not depressed? Like, wait a minute, you're going to give me a pill that's going to make all of a sudden I don't hate Kirk Cameron?
But what 8-year-old needs an antidepressant?
He doesn't take an antidepressant. And I shouldn't even be talking. My wife would fucking kill me if she heard
no
me.
No one listens to this show.
That's true.
It's true. No, there's not one impact. I say nigger every night. I'm trying to get attention.
A lot of people listen. I get a lot of.
Well, apparently nobody from Backlash Matter.
No,
I want their kind of attention. They get you pressed, man. Don't get your paid.
You don't
six.
Say the N word in a way that you mean it, though. You're
no, but
saying
I've been lately,
it as
I'm trying
joke.
To do it.
You're just trying to go there.
Like, you know, yeah, I used to say it in context, but now I'm saying like some nigger cut me off at the point. Like the way Levy says it.
Did I ever tell you I said that? That's when I knew I had to fucking move. I said the N word and meant it out loud when I was about. I guess when I first started comedy and I hadn't...
Wait a minute. You're Italian, you grew up outside of Philly, and you said the N-word?
I know, it's crazy, right?
Cool 60 Minutes.
But there was a black guy in my car with me.
Oh, well, that...
There was a black comic in the back seat, and someone cut me off on the road, a black guy, and I yelled the N-word out the fucking window with a black guy in the car with me.
Very nice.
What happened?
And, he was such a white black guy. He never said anything.
Who was it? Was it Chuck Nice?
I don't even know. I'm trying to remember his name. His name was Brian Williams. That's a pretty white name, right?
Brian Williams, the guy who lies?
No, it was the black comic Brian Williams.
Oh, well, I don't know.
And I remember because you know I grew up in that. My grandma was yelling the fucking N word every other 5 seconds.
Are you kidding me? My grandmother had a bat in her back seat that she called a nigger be good to.
Moulinion.
And she didn't even drive. Not like that. I mean, you know, racism is an important thing, right? We hate it.
It disgusts me.
Did you just say, yeah, we hate it?
We hate it, right, Andrew?
We hate it. We don't want to be racist.
Yeah, just play that as the promo. Mary, you're the most racist person I've ever met.
I'm not a racist at all. I come from Bensonhurst. We're not racist.
The most racist area.
You could be super racist. No one's going to hit you.
Yeah,
because
I know.
I come from
Because you're like 90 pounds.
Somebody's
and
blessed.
What are they going to do? 90 pounds? We think nobody ever swung at me?
They miss, right?
They miss.
Well, first of all, I think about that all the time. I don't know. I would have to load trucks for a living if I had to get another job. I would have to load a truck. I have no, it's 2016. I haven't sent an email yet. I haven't received one either, as far as I know.
Maybe well, it's like gambling. If you put a lot of money into like a machine, you don't want to walk away because you think someone else is going to get it. Like
that's
you said,
me.
But
that's the line thing.
Yeah,
you move but,
I didn't
want to
get off that table.
But also, there is that I put a lot of time and energy into this. I can't.
Of course,
quit.
You did.
Can't stop.
I
this
can't
is
stop.
What I. This is my skill. This is
this
what
is
I
what
do.
What you were born to do.
Yeah, I'm good at it. I mean, I don't want to start.
Just get rid of the Adderalls because
the Adderalls.
What you should do is stop taking the Adderall and sell it to comics. That's how you can make up some money.
Dude,
that's unbelievable. You know how much that shit's worth? The doctor was telling me the other day.
Oh, yeah. Forget, they sell them on the street.
He gives me, I get 3 pills a day given to me.
Holy shit, you could sell it for a lot of money.
Give me 2 and I'll get rid of them.
He sells candy on $20.
I think he said the 10 milligrams that I have are worth $40 to $50 a pill.
All right, I'll sell them for $100 in Coney Island. What are you laughing at?
You know, I get that markup.
I get that markup, M&M Skittle Adderalls.
I love the way Italians just fucking put an S on the end of everything for no reason.
Well, not all of us. Just Mario's, Bosco's.
All these Brooklyn Italians.
Barnes and Nobles.
Barnes and Nobles, do you say that?
Barnes and Nobles.
Barnes and Noble.
We used to go to this club called Enchante. Every Guido called it Enchante's. I'll never forget
Enchante.
It.
Enchante.
Where's that?
Was in Cherry Hill, man. Every Italian had a white Trans Am parked sideways in the parking lot.
Where you going? We're going to Enchante.
Enchante's.
We're going to Turquoise.
You're not going to make a life change at all. You're just mad. You're not in a bad mood anymore.
No, I still am. I mean, I've been just in a real shit mood. Just like can't. I think I'm out of it, and then it comes back again.
In other words, a better way of saying it is like if I didn't know you and I saw you do stand up one night and then you told me you were thinking of quitting, I would go, well, that's heartbreaking. You know. There are a lot of people who probably should quit.
I'm not thinking about quitting. That I'm not.
Okay.
I'm not. I'm just kind of, just mad.
What are you mad at?
I mean, you know, there's still, you know, we do. Like the other night was, the other night was fun, you know, the Borgata. We still got
those gigs. Well, I got a gig in Boston this Saturday. That's been depressing me. I'm trying to sell tickets in the summertime. It's just,
where is it?
Yeah, it's in Somerville, Mass, right outside of Boston at this theater.
Right.
That I had to rent. I had to pay the rent for the theater for the night, and I got.
Oh, you're doing that? Okay.
I'm doing one of those where I'm getting the whole door.
How is it? How's the tickets? I mean,
it's horrendous. Yeah, right. On a fucking August, you know, on a Saturday.
Who sells tickets? It's like, it's crazy. Like, you know, you can't, that's the other thing, you can't be delusional. Like, but when I got Howard, I had pretty much tried and pretty much failed at every. Well, I tried everything and I was done with it, like sketch comedy, sitcom, movies, and then you know, I would have to go back doing stand up. If the Stern Show didn't come about, which was a lot of it was a fluke, you know, it's a much different story I'm writing, much different. And 8 years on that is to the point where I could, you know, 6 years after not being on that show, I could still have gigs like the other night. But I'll tell you what, Jackie doesn't leave that show, or for some reason, you know, the Norm Show gets picked up for one more year and just straggles. I'd have been broke a couple, you know, it's just a different, it's so much luck involved with this fucking
thing. Yeah. Was there ever a time you would do a non-guarantee straight door, or were you always had a nice little guarantee in there?
No, it was always a guarantee.
Always.
Like, what do you mean? Like in the height of the Stern stuff, it was you know, God, my fucking aunt could have booked me or anything.
You wouldn't have been a gamble.
No,
but you still never did a show without a guarantee.
No, not through an agent, like a legit agent. That I had. Sometimes Levy would give me an offer, and I know that's what he was doing. But he would, you know, say you'll definitely look, you'll make this. But I know he was gambling.
Right.
But again, you know, one plug on Howard was just—it was such gold. It was unbelievable how jaded you get.
Have you had one gig since Howard where you just showed up and you were really disappointed you didn't make much because it didn't draw like you wanted it to?
Since Howard?
Yeah.
No.
Or even when you were on Howard?
No.
And not one where you're like, fuck.
That's how fast it was, too. That's how immediate it was. Before that, certainly. But no. I get, like the other night I made... Like the other night, you know, I made an extraordinary amount of money for being, and it's just because I got on that show, you know.
Can you remember any gigs before Howard?
Where yeah, definitely.
You would do it. You were getting a bonus if you did this, or
yeah, no, there was very very little bonuses.
But once you're on like Mad TV, weren't you making good money?
Yeah, I made better money, but But my God, I couldn't believe how extraordinary Stern was for like Mad TV worked with clubs. Howard, I went from like you know, Zany's 300 seats to Carnegie fucking Hall.
What was the first gig you did? How did you have to wait a certain amount of time before you were a regular on Howard before you could take it to the?
I didn't do any stand up for the first 5 months. Okay. I said to myself, I have to concentrate on being good on this show.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not going to have any distractions. I did nothing except just get up, and I was a radio guy. And then I booked a gig. Stutter and John was going to Comedy Connection in Boston. And that was a club I liked. I'd played before. And I said, let me come up with you there. I don't even care about the money. We'll just figure it out. So John said, Blumenroy said to me, the guy who runs the club, he said, who's closing? Because we were going with four people, like Florentine. He said, you should let Artie close because there's definitely like a buzz about him. Like it might be, and he's a comic, and you're not, to John, which is like 3 minutes. So I said, all right. I was a little worried about close, and I said, well, let Florentine close. So, you know, it was sold out, and, you know, when I got on stage, I could not believe it. It was like Springsteen singing Born to Run.
And you went 5 months without even doing a set?
No, the cellar and stuff like that.
Oh, you did sets.
Not the road. Just working on
material.
But
you at least not. You did not touch the stand-up.
All
stage.
I could do was talk about shit on the show for 20 minutes.
Right.
That's, you know, so I said, you know, that's extraordinary. That's the power of that fucking show, man.
Did you see what they did to Hillary Clinton? The FBI came in and swapped all the records.
What happens with the silence?
I know. What happened?
You talked.
What records? The emails?
Emails, whatever they had in boxes.
I thought you meant albums.
That's what I thought too. They took her first Rush album. You're not taking Zeppelin 4.
2112.
No, they don't want any of those. They want the real legal file.
Joe, do you feel like you were talking about the creative part too? Could you not do anything? If you had to do something for a living, it would have to be creative on some level. Do you think that?
I wish it. Sometimes I wish I could do something that wasn't creative and do it and like have it as a side thing.
But you can't.
I don't know.
I understand.
I don't know because I don't know how to. I couldn't stop this to go just start over at a thing and try to build it as a 48 turning 49 year old man.
Right. But Adrian, do you think you could do something? Like, would you have to like write on some level or be creative on some level, no matter what you did?
I think so. I think to not go like absolutely out of my mind, you know,
as an outlet, if you don't, Well, that's the other thing, Joe. With us, the age thing is like, you know, 50 years old is that age. I don't know about you, but that was always the age where you said, "Well, I don't want to wake up one day and be 50." And you know, that was always the example age. And we're there.
And we're there. It's fuck, dude. It's weird to see white hair, and it's odd. It is odd. It never feels normal.
50 is an... Paul Newman was 50 when he made Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Doesn't he seem like he was way more of a mature person? Like, I feel like I'm like a very immature 50. I guess we get to act like kids is what we do, but... I mean, just the fact that, you know, that gig the other night at the Borgata is we were technically making... That's what we do for a living. There's not a lot of responsibility there, except just remembering your act. I mean, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, it's pretty. It is a comfort, I guess, to know that you could just go up there and fucking wing it, and it'll work.
Right.
It's pretty. Not a lot of people.
You don't have to prepare.
I could be unprepared and do a good job.
Again, if that Albert Brooks movie "Defending Your Life" was the truth, and when you died, they showed you a tape of your life. If you watch my life, there would be a very, very overwhelming recurring theme of a lack of preparation. SATs. But see, those I failed. They were terrible. Both comedy. Yeah, you're right. Why?
Well, you were talking about brilliance earlier. Right. Now, you and I have talked about this before, that I think you would agree that if you think you're... brilliant or hilarious, right, or whatever your artisticness is, if you think you're great at it, you become not great at it. And I don't know if it's the same for athletes. Like if someone goes, I'm a fucking amazing baseball player, they start striking out.
Oh, okay. I'm trying to think. I don't know if I totally agree with that. I know what you're saying. You mean in comedy specifically?
Do you know any comedians that are great that think they're great comedians?
Well, mostly the norm is... I mean, it's funny. I said his name. Norm Macdonald would always say to me, he would be doing Letterman, you know, and I'd say to him, and there's 7 hours in between taping it and airing. And then I'd say, how'd it go? He goes, you know, that's terrible. And then I watch it. It's like one of the best I've ever seen.
Right.
You know, mostly the good ones think they suck.
I'm trying to think of, do you know any that think they're good that are good?
I think there are.
There's something Billy to be Crystal said about people who are like super confident that do really well in this business, though.
I'm not talking about doing well, just actually where they're respected by comedians and audience.
The opposite is usually true. You know, like Mario thinks he's great.
Yeah. I don't think I'm great. I'm starting out. I think I did good the other night.
See, that's what I mean.
Do you think like a great actor thinks he's a great actor?
No.
Yes. I think so. Yeah, because I think they're more... A comic, I think, is more intelligent. Like, Chris Rock is not as good in a movie as Chris Tucker is. Because Chris Tucker is probably almost retarded. It's like, you know...
Right.
I'll be anything you want. I'll be a tree. I don't give a shit. Chris Rock's like, I'm not a tree. Right. You know. They analyze it. We overanalyze shit, so you're not... acting, yes.
Yeah. Norm said that somewhere about Sinbad. That they were doing the Montreal Comedy Festival together, like, way back when. And Norm had to sit there and spend hours upon hours preparing. And he had always was sitting down and writing and writing and writing and coming up with clever material. And then Sinbad and him were going to be on the same show. And Sinbad calls him on the phone earlier in the day and goes, "Hey, man, I need socks for tonight's show. You want to come with me and buy some socks?" Did you ever hear this story?
Mm-mm.
I think he told it on somebody's podcast, maybe Marin's. And he goes with fucking Norm and they buy socks together. And then they go up on stage that night and Norm does his, you know, written great material and the audience likes it. And then Sinbad goes on after him and just talks about buying socks at the fucking mall. and destroys. And Norm's analogy is that those are the guys that should have their own shows, like, about them, because they can, they have that charisma
yeah.
is the important thing to have a show to build around. Like a clever, smart comedian can be kind of boring, maybe, even though Norm did. I wish Artie's in the bathroom right now. He'll be back, but
he's taking a diabetic piss.
So yeah, so but Norm did have a television show, and he probably was pretty, had a lot of charisma, but he probably thought he didn't. So that's why he told the story about Sinbad.
I heard what you just said. Yeah, I remember that story.
He told it on Marin's podcast.
That makes but that makes sense. That one guy's more of a writer, the other guy's a performer. You know,
there are definitely comics like that.
Yeah, but I think Norm found his perfect niche with Weekend Update, and then he became famous enough to get a show and a movie, you know.
But I think Norm's one of those guys that the no charisma is actually charisma,
right?
You know what I mean?
He's like the anti-hero.
Yeah, it's the awkward pause is really funny when he does it.
Yeah, and he does it all the time. He does it in real life.
Yeah,
it's very, it's disarming.
Yeah, you know? it's funny when he's just standing there
and he looks at you and dares you to laugh.
Yeah.
Which, you know, and then even if he bombs, but yeah, a lot of funny guys bomb. I think. I think a lot of us are used to that in comedy.
I think most,
right? They do. I told you that.
Yeah, I think most.
Most, yeah. Well, you know,
sometimes
Todd Glass is an example of that.
Yeah,
hilariously funny. Sometimes, you know.
But sometimes, if you like, I don't ever listen to the comedy channels on Sirius XM. But just like every once in a while, I'll go, let me put that on for a second. And if you listen, you go.
That's
like
awful.
But you could listen to like old Pryor, like, or old anybody.
It depends.
Well, there's nothing but old Pryor.
It depends what you listen.
Carlin, Pryor, like all the greats.
No, but they have different stations. Like some of it's like clean or something.
Well, yeah, I think one of them's just called Comedy Greats or Comedy Legends or something like that.
I'm an uneducated white guy.
But sometimes you listen and you really, it gives you a new perspective on stand-up, because you'll listen to someone who's great and they're not really like, it's not like the crowd's going fucking ape shit. They're just really, they're enjoying it, and it's, they're interested, and
that's
it's getting laughs.
You didn't have to kill in the old days. That became a new, like the way we sometimes want to, like the way I think people point to when they write articles about it, like Eddie Murphy's delirious, like that, you know.
That's what I was going to say. Do you feel like that was like a black comic type of thing, like just killing so hard where the audience is like getting up and running around the room laughing?
Yeah, I think that says more about the audience than the comic, though, at times, because, you know, some people just don't have a good time. They do that in church.
Well, that, yeah, maybe. I think Eddie Murphy might have been the first guy that was getting a big response off of the
like
performance.
Applause,
the,
you know.
And it was the performance of the joke.
Watching old Letterman before, like, Arsenio Hall started, I think, with the fucking dog pound, the whoop, whoop, whoop,
woo,
and fucking,
woo, woo.
And then Leno embraces it like an idiot. Like, I think Jay Leno's a great comic, but, you know, he's running into the crowd. Could anything look more awkward? Like his dog pound. And so now when you do a talk show, it's got to be huge laughs and doing applause. Sometimes they don't even laugh. They applaud. Who the fuck knows how to react to that? You watch an old Letterman, and it's just, it's like him and Albert Brooks. I was watching one with him and John Candy. John Candy has a cigarette, and they're sitting there. It's like 1983. And it's just like the audience chuckles and acknowledges it, but it's two like witty guys having a conversation. And it's really entertaining to me.
Right, right.
And not everything John Candy said had to be an enormous fucking bam, bomb hitting. But now that's the standard. Now, especially young kids, that's all they want to do is it's got to destroy or they won't put it on their Twitter page.
Right.
And the Twitter, kids don't want to take risks because if they take a risk, they might bomb. And it'll be on Twitter bombing. And think about it, I don't blame them for that. Would you have liked it if Twitter was around when we were 28 years old? I wouldn't have. I think it's way harder. Because you're immediately judged. Immediately. And it could be a new thing you're doing. It would make me get discouraged to do new shit anywhere.
Yeah, especially.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. When they can film it and stick it somewhere.
So how do you write new material? You know, if
you're famous, you mean?
Well, no, or if even, you know, because if you're not a famous comic, you have a clique of people that still might see it. And you're embarrassed for, you know, it used to be just those people and you in the room. Like if you're doing Midnight at the Funny Bone in Pittsburgh, it was just you and those 300 people, whatever. And you said what you had to say to get the fuck out of that room, or you could experiment with new stuff. Now it's you and the whole fucking world. One guy's got to get pissed. Like what Tracy Morgan said, like when he got in trouble. Now, look, you can't defend what Tracy Morgan said, if you remember. It was rather bad. But in the old, he almost lost his job.
What did he say?
Something about gays,
I can't
right?
remember.
He said, I believe, I'm paraphrasing, but I'm almost, he said, if my son told me he was a faggot, I would stab him to death. Okay. Not
the
defend
two
that.
Death part is very
not really extreme. Not really defendable, I guess. But in the old days, you never would have heard about it. Never would have heard about it.
Sure, no.
The kids.
Who's gonna, oh, yeah, who's gonna say? You know, the waitresses are gonna get mad at the fucking. He was in Kansas City when it happened. Now one guy got offended and put it on Twitter what he said, and all of a sudden he's getting fired at 30.
The waitresses. That's hilarious. That's another thing people don't even realize that like. We're being reported on by the waitresses. That's who decides.
Right. If you're
especially
not doing well,
then,
they're going to be like, that person bombed.
And I'll tell you what, and they are hard to make laugh. A comedy club waitress, usually they're very... I told you that one that I was trying to get out of the bathroom. And I never heard a more like ordering condescending. I'm taking a dump. She went up on dump. And very, very mad person. She needs a career change.
I always think it's weird when people make people apologize.
I could
apologize.
Use someone in Coney Island.
What, say again?
Like when people have to apologize for something. Because you know it's not authentic. There.
Well, I never do it right. I always end up not apologizing because I can't stop laughing. I get through halfway through the apology. Howard made me, I had to apologize to gays on Howard. I forget what I said.
Did the gays embrace you then?
No, it was worse. Because I couldn't get through it. I laughed through the whole thing. They wanted me.
Was that your HBO Aspen story?
No, that was a fluke. I mean, again, I said I smell dick. Did you burp to the most powerful gay guy in show business? Peter Principato was so mad. It's like, what did you do? I'm like, I don't know. I was goofing. I said it's like a stupid thing you say at a club. I wasn't. He goes, no, you know, you said it to Michael Patrick King. I said, no, I don't know. I should have known the guy sitting to the left of Sarah Jessica Parker was gay.
She just said to Neil Patrick Harris.
Well, no, I wouldn't say it to him on purpose. But, maybe did it cost me opportunities? I don't fucking know.
Yeah, you can't overthink that stuff.
Yeah, what am I going to do? I guess there's definitely people who don't like me.
I mean, I'm sure that there's some. I feel like Joe has definitely burned some bridges.
Me too.
Yeah, but then what are you going to do? Go around being fake all the time?
I told you this one time in a crack house, I burned Todd Bridges.
Yeah. So
why do you think he's burned Bridges? What do you mean?
Because Joe is Joe.
Well, how is Joe Joe? Like, am I missing something?
Joe will just say what he wants to say.
Is that true? This Joe?
Yes.
Well, like what? Give me an example.
I don't know specific examples.
I don't know of a Joe who just burns that many bridges. I mean,
maybe not that many.
Joe,
there's been a few bridges.
Well, what are they?
It's all stuff you probably know. I mean,
I'm trying to think of a major bridge.
When I would get heckled bad, I would, I would come back hard.
I remember what you said. Okay,
they heckled.
That's a
I
fucked
came
up.
Back
no,
hard.
But that you were that people overreacted. And the one thing I'm thinking of where you didn't play a certain club for a while. You know what I'm talking about? The owner got mad at you.
Yes, yes.
I don't think I. Did you think you were in the wrong there?
That's a tough
one. I don't think you are. I know the whole...
No, because I understand where the brain goes for a comedian. But I guess if you're not a comedian, you don't understand that when that happens, you're outside of yourself in a way. And anger drives a comedian. That's why a lot of us
become
comedians.
Yeah, you were reacting to something. And to my opinion, they didn't. They should have understood that.
Right. It's like if somebody hits you, you might hit them harder back.
Right.
If they fucking, it hurt. Now I'm going to hit you harder.
Well, now you sound like the Westies.
20 times. I mean, yeah.
Yeah. Well, and look, you didn't say anything that was untrue. I mean, the Jews did kill Christ, right? No, I'm kidding. I hear you. You do. So I'm bad with that, too. Someone hit you with a water pistol, you come back with a bazooka.
Yeah.
There's some great comics who have, been talking about burning bridges. It was a very great comic, comes to my mind, who is banned from clubs.
Who was the comic near? I forget. I'm not going to say his name. There's a very known comedian
right.
that I think, went on the Tonight Show drunk.
Right.
And just fucking, they couldn't air it.
Went on the Tonight Show drunk.
That, there's a famous story
of a Boston comedian. How long ago?
15, 20
it?
Years ago, probably.
Oh, a Boston comic.
Boston
yeah.
comic.
I know you're talking about, yep.
They never put him on again. Right. He's known as like a genius. Everybody idolizes this comic in Boston.
Well, the jokes that I've heard from him that are quoted are very good.
Yeah, funny ones.
Yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. Well, yeah, I hear you. There's another Boston guy who I'm thinking of too.
You're lucky that you could pull off funny drunk, Artie.
Well, I listen. Listen, that Joe Buck thing. That Joe Buck thing is. If you look at that, what I said there, I should not be in show business. Cool. Yeah. I mean, his kids were there. The first joke had the word cocksucker in it.
Were you drunk?
If you call 15 Adderall drunk, no. No, I took a bunch of painkillers.
You did?
With booze.
You weren't sober, is what you're saying. You weren't in your normal...
I would say I was very far away from the word sober. I was high. I was on opiates.
Right.
And, yeah. But I probably would have said the same thing, though. I had a cigarette that I threatened to light.
So but funny. You really didn't care at the same time.
Well, here's the thing. What I hated about that was people thought I was trying to ruin Joe Buck. I wasn't. I liked Joe. I was trying to help him out. It was a bore fest up until then because Chad Ochocinco promised to announce something and didn't. Brett Favre promised to announce something and didn't. So those two guys without a football in their hand and no big announcement, guess what? It's like flies fucking.
But that's what's hard about comedy sometimes is bombing gets you your check and going for the kill and fucking lighten up the it gets exciting when
here's
that
the thing.
Shit's
here's
going
the,
on.
This was live HBO, okay? Right. Like a real buzz in the air, like packed to the gill. And okay, after those guys had dead silence, like, you know, Joe Namath came on and was, you know, stumbling over a story. So they showed a video, and there was three people, and they said, you're going to be the comedy part of it. And, like, especially that, the fucking producer I got into a fight with in the New York Post, Ross Greenberg, everyone knows who was there. He said this to me. He goes, go nuts. Just go nuts. And Joe Buck said, let me have it. And Joe admits that. The two other guys were three of us. Jason Sudeikis, who I did not know. I didn't know who he was at the time. I should have been up on that, but at the time I didn't know who he was. I know he was making out with the chick from Mad Men, January Jones, and I said, okay, that kid's got something going. And I said, that kid's funny.
You didn't see Hall Pesh.
No, well, I didn't know who he was, but he was just about to get a little more funny. And Paul Rudd was the other guy.
Paul Rudd, yeah.
Paul Rudd, who's friends with Joe Buck. They went to high school together. So, you know, they went to Rudd first, and... it was tanking, then they went to me, and then the first thing out of my mouth got an enormous laugh at an applause break. So as a comic, that was it. I just kept going, and I went too far.
Right.
I'll be the first one, man.
Right.
But I got the first, you know, 3 minutes was nonstop laughs. The last, like, half, the last 30 seconds was like, whoa. Yeah.
I always compare those moments to in the movie Goodwill Hunting when Matt Damon at the beginning of the movie is punching the kid on the schoolyard,
right,
and
right.
then he can't stop until the kid's almost dead.
Well,
and they got to pull him off. That's how comedians are.
That was me that night.
Yeah.
That's a perfect example.
You're like,
because it looked like I was fucking with him. And then I started doing an impression of his father, which people thought I was fucking with his father. Right. I love his father. But that was killing. And then it started to get like, okay, this is a little much because Sudeikis and Paul Rudd. See, they're not comedians, though. Jason works on SNL, but they're not comics, like working a crowd type of thing. And, you know, I just said, well, okay, I don't care if Paul Rudd ever talks again. And when they stopped the fucking segment, Paul Rudd leaned into me and said, you realize what you just did was legendary. That's what he said to me. And so I left there thinking everything is honky-fucking-dory. This was great. I get to Howard the next morning. Howard's giggling. He goes, have you seen the Post? I go, no. Why? He goes, okay, we'll talk about it later. And the Post said, I think I did great. I think I saved the show. The Post says, headline, Artie Lang banned from HBO Sports. And then after we talked about it, Howard leaned to me and said, dude, this is the greatest thing ever. This is rock and roll. He goes, this is what happened to me. You know, you're fired. You those uptight pricks, you made them mad. You're like the fucking Bill Murray in Caddyshack. And after Howard gave me that pill, I was like, "That's you're right." I felt great about it.
Right. You well, love that.
Every uptight person wrote stuff that I couldn't write better myself. You know, Francesa went on the air and goes, "Oh, this fucking monster starts talking about Buck, and he's insulting all groups of people like gays." I didn't make Mike Francesa laugh.
Too bad for him.
And Mad Dog Russo said, "Oh, you know, Artie, I like Artie. I like works blue. I works blue. Works blue." I don't know. He sounded like Steve Allen. "Works blue, Artie. I don't know. Yeah, I like him. Funny. Works blue." I don't know. You know what I mean? I don't know, man. You know, Gelb over there behind the dish. I don't like blue comics. I don't. You know, whatever. I don't like. The least hip 42-year-old. Yeah. Hey, Mark Blow.
He had you on, though, right? Right
oh,
after
yeah.
that.
He was always not. Well, I told the joke on Chris Russo that to this day he can't believe I'm not. I don't live in Canada. And I told him, I said, "Okay." I said, "I'll leave." We were outside the Springsteen concert because he did remotes from Springsteen, and he saw I was walking in. He said, "I'll tell Artie to come on." We talked about Bruce and everything, and then at the end he goes, "You got any good sports jokes?" And I go, "Actually, the most offensive joke I've ever heard in my life is about sports." And he goes, tell us. I go, no, Christian, you don't know what you got into. And he goes, "Come on, tell us." I go, "It's horrible. It's really, really bad." So then Russo goes to his producer, "I don't know, should we let him tell us?" And the producer was a younger guy. He goes, "Well, he's on the Stern Show. They could do whatever they want. They own Sirius." And he goes, "I guess so." And there's a live crowd there. I go, "You really want me to tell us? Because it's really bad." I go, "Tiger Woods." He goes, "Yeah. How do you get the name Tiger?" "I don't know. His mother's from Thailand and his father's a nigger."
Oh.
Okay.
Oh, my God.
Okay. You're talking... Four of my cousins were there laughing.
Oh, my God.
Laughing harder than they ever laughed. Some people laughing, drunk people laughing, other people horrified, like they're watching their cat get raped. There's dead silence. The producer has his head down, and Chris Russo is like in a coma stare. And then he just goes, "Wow." Let's go to commercial.
I was going to say, he had to fade to commercial.
I said, "I told you."
What did he say off air?
He said, "Listen, wow. I dropped the ball there. I should listen to you."
And it was. And it was.
I dropped the ball there. It was live.
They couldn't dump that?
No, with the remote, they had no delay with them.
No
remote.
Delay.
Because
boom.
He never needs one.
Did you have to apologize?
Yeah, he doesn't curse.
No one assumes.
Artie or Howard always tries to make him curse, and he won't.
Yeah, no, he never does. That's right, it's his thing.
Yeah.
And I don't think anyone ever assumes that joke would be told on a show.
Did you have to apologize for that?
No one ever talked to me about it.
How did he?
That support. You know what I thought I was going to get? No one ever brought it up. But Howard might have secretly been mad.
I'm surprised he didn't see it coming as soon as you said tie. He knew what the rest of the word was, girl.
No, he did not see that coming.
He should have had a Heisman.
Listen, let me tell you
arm in your face.
I'm with a longshoreman told me that joke, an old friend of mine, and I was offended. Like, that is startling. Like, that's when the N-word is startling. That's whoa.
That's when it's actually funny, when it's so...
But that's the thing. That's what people don't get. It's like, you can't say, replace that word with the N-word, saying the N-word, because, in other words, like, when you say the full word, it shows you how startling it is. Like, you want to say it because you see how offensive it is.
What?
It's the granddaddy of them all. There's nothing that comes close in racist terms.
What's that Jamal joke? Oh, I forget it. I'm sorry.
AJ Jamal?
No. There's the punchline is something Jamal. I don't know. It's a black Spanish joke. I don't remember it.
Is it your joke?
No. Someone told it on my podcast. They left it on the voicemail. Something Jamal. You win Jamal. What the fuck is it?
In some ways, that
something
might
like
be,
that is the punchline.
In some ways, that might be the most offensive joke I've ever heard because. You know, it just, it's just like, the punchline is not even, like, it just lays there in a way, too, like, at his father's name. I mean, the look on his face was like, oh, my God. Like he couldn't believe someone said that.
And that he let you say an offensive joke. And yeah, like, go ahead, Artie.
Well, he coaxed you into doing it.
Well, and I warned him. I said, listen, Chris, you sure?
It's like having Buddy Hackett on and going, yeah, go ahead.
Let it loose.
Go. We don't have a dump button.
But yeah, that is an example where you're talking about like comics like to have. So I don't think a lot of younger comics like that badge of honor with the outlaw. But I started to get upset. And then after Howard talked to me about it, he goes, dude, this is the great. This is rock and roll, man. This is what you want to do. And he goes, so what are you not going to get a Sprite commercial? Who gives a shit? And I'd like a Sprite commercial. But yeah, that is why I'm doing this. I don't want to do it. You don't want to live like when people get offended in the audience at a comedy club. I feel like going. You should want to live vicariously through. Like I figured, like you're in a cubicle at a marketing job where your boss looks at everything you email and tweet because you might get offended. You're living under fucking Sharia law, man.
Yes,
I'm a comic. I can say whatever. I'm here. I'm making money. Do whatever you want to do.
Someone was telling me recently that they were at some open mic and these comics are doing political jokes at these like new comics.
Right.
And one of the comics actually got mad at the other comic after the show for making fun of Hillary. And they called into the podcast, my podcast again, and they go, what do you think of this? And I said, if you're a comedian, you're not allowed to get offended by things. That's just a rule of being a comedian. Like you're terrible if you're offended. Yeah. You're offended by a Hillary? That's ridiculous. I don't care what your belief is. I don't know. It didn't tell me.
If a guy's offended by Hillary,
you can't get offended by things.
Ugh, that's such a pussy move.
Hillary Clinton, what a waste.
She Mayer's got a lot of good observational stuff.
No, but I like, for instance, they keep yelling, lock her up, you know, still, like, how could you...
Dan, we could just take a break.
I wouldn't vote for her.
Well, the levers are very high, aren't they?
Ooh. Oh, I thought that was a fall.
I don't know if this is... I don't buy this either, first. What is she doing? She's making this up? Like, what is that? And what... Do they take a drug, these poor little girls that make their head like that? Like, why is her head the same head?
They practice.
No, but why is her head, why do all their heads go up in a V? Like, you know what I mean? These little gymnast girls. And look at this chick.
Yeah, that'd be funny to try to do all those. I guess you could never do all those moves with your hair just flying in your eyeballs.
No, I know. She's got a lot of hair, too. Look at her shoes. I mean, and look at her coach, this chick. Like, let's go eat my pussy.
Oh, God.
Time to munch and hunch.
We're paused right now.
We're
going. I thought he said let's go to commercial.
What talking for? Yeah. Did you got Adrian? Are you entertained by the Olympics? A lot of people love the Olympics. So I don't.
No, I'm only watching it because we're here and it's on.
No, we put it on because last night we were goofing on it. But you know, the joke I have is it's the last place where you're allowed to be racist. You're allowed to hate somebody just because they're from another country. Like, I'm rooting against you. Why? Because you're from Germany.
That's funny.
Only reason why.
Yeah, and but then if, like, Italy is playing against, like, a black American, you're still going for Italy.
Oh.
Hell yeah.
You see, okay, so now I'll buy that tag from you.
He's going to buy it.
There you go.
How much you want for that?
That's funny.
Yeah, that's funny until I do it in front of a fucking millennial named Moan.
Everyone moans. I was at. Fuck I did. Off.
That doesn't
did
even mean they don't like it.
I did a show before I came here, and there was like three people in the audience that liked me, and the rest didn't.
Well, how many people in the audience?
No, 40.
There's that. I know what Joe's saying too. Is like,
first of all, I've mostly seen Joe just kill. Yeah. I've rarely ever seen you not do like destroy.
I've been working with you for a long time. I've never seen
Hartford when I walked off.
With me?
No, I told you the story on your podcast.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, we all, you know, everybody has.
I got my car and went home, Adrian. You would have loved that story.
Oh, that story is great.
5 minutes in, I just walked off.
What happened?
Did you tell that on the air here?
Yeah. Yes. And then we elaborated. We had two different times in my career where I just.
Can you
I
give
gave
me the
up.
Short version of it?
Wait a minute, at Carnegie Hall, but you didn't bomb at Carnegie Hall, you killed.
Oh, Carnegie
Hall. No, I didn't do that
Carnegie
well at Carnegie
where you were
Hall.
Getting cursed at by
I got
fans?
A lot of Artie yells.
No, he did a great thing where he...
Yeah, I called a guy a cunt. In front of my parents.
My mother's here, you cunt.
That's what it was. My parents are here, you cunt. And it was a guy.
All right, Dan, take a pause.
I won't ask you to cut this out.
Can't hear my. Oh, there we are. We're in. Very active between segments. By the way, Trump. What do I hear now?
Oh, that's TV.
By the way, Trump officially said the thing, that if they can, he's trying to say he didn't say this, but clearly he did say the evil thing. And if they can prove he did, it's over. It's got to be over. Do you know what I'm talking about, Dan, what he said
yes.
today?
Yes, the Second Amendment.
Yeah,
people
well,
can
I'm
going to
tell
her.
The story. Yeah.
Hopefully you didn't hear that.
Yeah, so Trump's talking about Hillary Clinton today about how, you know, we got to, what is that?
Oh, it's me trying to move the box.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
That's
all right. Well, again, it's not exactly,
it's all right.
You know, secure in here. It's not your fault. It's not great stuff. So Trump basically inadvertently.
Sorry, I'm just
Jesus.
I'm trying to get this.
It's not your fault. Just are you comfortable now? Just let me know.
I'm great.
Okay.
Do you want a phone book?
Again,
love a phone book.
Though. Again, it's not. It's not your fault.
You want an apple
yeah,
box?
Yeah, that should be. No, yeah. Let's raise it up a little bit.
I don't think you can.
I think
you?
It's.
Yeah, we'll get a book. Yeah, we'll get a book.
Or just put it on this. I think it was on the arm of the chair before. Just sit
yeah,
it right
but you
there.
Shouldn't have to lean forward like that.
No, she won't.
She's
if
trying to be
on
witty.
She
shouldn't be comfortable.
She's trying to be witty.
I'm a woman. I shouldn't be comfortable.
She's trying to be witty.
There we go.
Dan, she's passive aggressive, threatening a lawsuit here.
Also, all these baby pictures.
No, wait a minute.
Yeah, Artie. I got Artie laying in between my legs.
That's the mother.
Jesus.
That is well, a lot of
they're bigger than I thought.
and browner.
Yeah. That's why I like him brown.
Oh, my God. Do you?
Oh, my God.
I'm
don't
kidding.
Say
I'm
that.
Kidding. I'm fine with it.
What do you mean you're kidding?
I said I'm kidding.
They would hang you in Bensonhurst if you...
Yeah, well, I want to get hung in. I want to get unhung in Hollywood, jerk off. They don't shoot movies in Bensonhurst. At Thanksgiving, we'll say the truth. Thanksgiving Eve, actually. Is it good now?
It's great.
All right.
Thank you.
Well, I mean, that's dripping with sarcasm.
No, this is perfect.
I was going to
ask for something before, but I was like, I guess I should just be happy I'm here.
No. What, are you getting that vibe?
I'm kidding.
I don't know if you're kidding.
I'm kidding.
No, Joe and I got off on a tangent. The 50 people who are against Trump. Okay, so Trump today is getting so mad at these people, and they're baiting him. So here's what he says today. He basically told people maybe to shoot Hillary Clinton. He's all mad. He's saying she's the devil. And he's saying, well, you know, there's nothing we can do about it if she gets all the votes. And he said maybe the Second Amendment people can do something about it. And the Second Amendment people are the gun people.
Mm-hmm.
And it's clear.
Does he know he's not a comedian?
Wait. It's clear. That's the problem.
And they said, we can't support Donald Trump. The reason they can't, you know why? Because I'm not going to hire these people. I don't want these people.
But as he struggles to keep his party in line,
well, that should be,
in the polls,
if he plays
Trump says the key to victory is more of the same.
I've always had a good temperament.
He's always had a good temperament.
I certainly don't think it's appropriate to start changing all of a sudden.
Dad, can you play the audio of me and him on Stern from 05? This is goes from praising me to calling me a loser in 4 seconds. I'm a D-list comic. This is how easy you can bait him. I roasted him in 2004. About 4 months later, he comes on the show, and you know, well, I'll see if we can play it. So now everybody's saying to him, you basically told people to shoot Hillary Clinton. And incite, and he goes, I was telling the Second Amendment people to exercise the right to vote. And it's clear that's not what he was, not what he was saying. I don't know, man.
Do you think he's that dumb that he was really meaning it that way?
Yeah, I think he said it
not
that way.
Not dumb.
I think he said it a certain way where it could be construed to shoot her, but not even dumb.
Anger takes over.
You think so? Okay, like
well,
what
we
were saying before.
Well, haven't you said stuff you regret in anger?
Sure, yeah,
that's
like
exactly
we were just
what
saying.
That's exactly
okay.
What's happened to him. And that's the point. As a president, you should be able to get over that.
Secret
well, that's what they've been saying about...
...of Mr. Trump's comments.
But that's what they've been saying about Trump from the beginning, is that
right,
we
and they've been right.
We, yeah, and that if you push him, that
but,
whole snap.
I golf with the guy, too, and if you say nice socks, he'll say something, like, evil about your, you know, family.
Just said some evil about his headpiece.
He's a guy you want to hang out with, though. Like, he's a guy, like, almost a neighborhood kid. We've been knowing him for... I golfed with him and Eli Manning, 9 holes at this charity event. By the end, me and Trump were bullying Eli Manning, like, goofing on him, calling him retarded, mouth breather. And we were really having a fun time. Talking about chicks. talking about chicks. Like every other LaHole had a hot looking chick, and he's like, you know, he's a fun guy.
Wouldn't that be great if he became president just so you could say that? Like, holy shit, you know.
I hung out with the president.
I went golfing with this guy.
Well, I developed a bit of a relationship with him, and yeah. It was like he saw me and he rolled his eyes like, okay, well, now we're going to bust chops. Like, I have, like I just sent the picture from that day because I asked my cousin to complete the foursome. He's a great golfer, and he got a kick out of it. It was really sort of thrilling to do that, but... you know, I sent it to Trump to see if he would sign it. He signed it in 2 seconds. How you doing and stuff like that? I'm like, how you doing? But, you know, he's catching a lot of shit to where they're, and Hillary Clinton's got that machine behind her. And they're baiting him. And, you know, again, like you said, is he that dumb? But he's not that dumb. He's that angry. He's that sort of, like, vindictive. And you really can't be that way. You do have to show restraint. And why, he's a construction guy. He's a one generation removed construction guy from Queens. He was raised by a guy who was a construction worker from Queens. He's a New York loudmouth.
I don't know.
What?
I'm just curious if a lot, because I only know a few guys that are like money guys like that, and I wonder if that's like a common trait.
What are they? Are they
when
the
you're
same
that
way?
Way, that
are they the same way though?
They are used to having power.
Right. But, I mean, it's also the kind of business he's from. The construction in New York City, the people you deal with are really dangerous people. The best part about the whole primary thing with Ted Cruz accused him of dealing with mafia types. And Trump was so funny. He was so dead honest. He goes, I build 80-story towers in Manhattan. Who do you think takes the garbage away, Ted? And he's right.
Right.
It's all mafia guys. And the one guy was Eddie the Neck Canelli. Like, and it would look so funny. And he goes, yeah, I know Eddie the Neck Canelli. He takes the sheetrock.
Right.
And no one else is allowed to take the sheetrock.
But don't you think to be a Donald Trump, you have to be that kind of a person that knows how to control those types?
Not
so he has to be a strong person.
Not in business.
No?
In business, you can be like he is.
That's what I'm saying.
You have to be diplomatic in politics.
No, yeah, that's exactly right.
Okay.
That's what I meant. That's what I meant.
Right.
He's trying to fake
over.
That he's
okay,
diplomatic.
Okay, I thought you were saying he had to be that in business.
No, I'm saying...
Some businesses, maybe, but not construction.
Not that level of business and that type of business.
Because all you have to care about is that. There's no other... The blowback of how China's going to think her, it doesn't matter, but yeah... And he's not,
and
like
don't
you just said, Adrian, he's not diplomatic.
And to be the level of Trump is in that business, don't you have to just fuck over people like crazy?
Would you vote
that's
for
all,
him?
That's all he's been doing.
Huh?
Would you vote for him?
For Trump?
Yeah.
I don't want to piss Artie's fans off, but no, I didn't plan.
Well, what are your fans doing? Are they online to see the next exhibit?
No, I mean, no, I know a lot of my fans are Trump people, too, and I you know.
All of our fans are Trump.
A lot of them are.
Clinton?
go to a shoot like crashing and stuff, like I can say now. Or any, I've been on a couple of things in the last like year. It is to a man, every crew guy, every Teamster is Trump, and they hate every actor and actress because they overhear the liberals and how they talk politics. They think they're condescending towards them.
Wasn't there a news story today that someone was wearing a Trump shirt in Staten Island and got fucking like, did he get killed?
A guy had a Trump thing on his lawn, like a huge Trump tee, and they set it on fire.
They set it on fire.
Right. That's, I tell you what, though.
Was that in Staten Island?
Staten Island.
Right.
I would think a lot of Staten Island's voting Trump, though.
He said he has 100%.
The entire island.
All Italians.
You know, again, he won New York in the primaries. He won all the boroughs except one. Guess which one he lost?
The Bronx?
Manhattan.
Manhattan, right.
Of course he lost Manhattan, because that's where Tina Fey lives. I'm saying it's an example. Of course, that's why.
Right.
And these Teamster guys are so. They talk to me because they assume I'm one of them, and I am. I'd much rather talk to them than most people above mine. And they're honest with me, and they go, you know, they hear these actors and actresses and the way they treat them, and they feel they're condescending and arrogant towards them, and they feel that's what Hillary Clinton is, and Trump is one of them. And that's why he's got a hope. There's one sort of base that they call it now, I guess, in politics. I've been watching every fucking day because it's so fucking entertaining. There's one base he has. There's one constituency he has, and that's uneducated, white, blue-collar males. And it's basically exactly what I am, except the blue-collar, which I would be if I didn't get lucky. It's white guys who didn't go to college. That's his. That's who, almost every one of them say Trump. So I think he's got to hope those guys come out in record numbers to vote.
I didn't go to college.
And every single one of them. Every single one of them votes for him. He's got to make sure he gets 100% because he's getting hardly any women, right?
I'm surprised. I would think their wives would vote for them.
Well, I think the wives,
if they know it's good for them,
when they're in the booth, that's the one place they can be themselves.
I hung out with
Pete. Send your wife in the booth.
I hung out with Pete Dominic recently, who does political talk radio, and he was telling me that he knows for a fact that Donald Trump doesn't have a chance.
Well, I now, well, first of all, it's not so going out on a limb now.
No, this was a month ago.
Yeah. Well, and what did you say? Like, what's he alluding to?
He's just saying that he knows the numbers and he doesn't have a chance.
Well, now the numbers are obvious. After that fucking that Middle Eastern couple with the son who died at the convention. Please tell me you know what I'm talking about. Do you not know what I'm talking about?
Nope.
Joe, you know what I'm talking about?
Adrian, help me out.
I know
out
what
here.
You're talking about, and I've seen it on Facebook, and I was like, I don't care.
No, I know, but people do, though.
I know.
You really don't know about the family he got into an argument with?
Yeah, and then everybody came out, and that was a big deal.
Dan, Joe doesn't know about the con family.
Please, don't tell Dan that. I don't want to see that.
You know what, though, Joe? That is actually one where that's astonishing. You're going to go on red eye not knowing?
I think that's why they like me on the show. But it's what took him out.
You realize how big that might be the biggest political story in the last 20 years, because it's what took Trump out. They were wondering what was going to take him out, and that's the thing that took him out is why it's so big. And, well, you have to know it. I'm not going to let you go on there without knowing it, because that'll be brutal. A Muslim couple whose son fought for this country and died as a hero in 2006 as a soldier went to on the Democratic convention and called Trump a hate monger, a racist, and said he doesn't even know the Constitution and pulled out a copy of it and said, I will lend you my copy. This is the Constitution. Did you even read it? And his wife sat there and didn't say anything. She was in like a burqa and didn't say a word, the wife. She looked like Pete Rose. Look, my wife looks like Pete Rose. You've got that Russian model parading her around with the shaved pussy. Did you? You want to see my wife? Charlie Hustle here doesn't shave.
Charlie.
Look at her. She's just looking at the camera. Trump said way less than what I just said. But so Trump just points out, and he shouldn't have done that. So they have a kid who died in the war. Trump gets asked about it, and he goes there.
I know about this.
Yeah, he
said but that, I'm so bad at like remembering the. I heard the story.
Right, he said,
but I can't retell the story.
He said, why didn't she say anything? But so, and again, I think Trump is weird with.
Wait,
like,
what did Trump say? He just said, why didn't the wife say again?
Well, yeah, that's why it's no big deal to me, because Trump didn't figure out the right way to spin it, which is astonishing to me. He said, look, the wife was just standing there, didn't say a thing. Maybe she wasn't allowed to say a thing. So they claimed that was attacking her. To me, he's attacking the religion that doesn't let her say anything, which Hillary Clinton gets a lot of donations from. So instead of saying that, he just lets people go, you attack this woman. He did. What I just did was attacking the woman.
I think that's a lot less worse than half the other shit he's done.
I agree. But these people, right. they have a kid who died. The guy was like a hero.
Right.
So everybody harped on
but
it.
But it's
and,
not like he
and
said.
And then the polls come out and he's. It's the first time he's getting killed.
Yeah, but I figured he would have said something like, your kid's not a hero. Like, didn't he do that to him?
Yeah, you're right.
That's what I thought he was going to say.
That's a good point. When you hear the reaction, you think that's what he said.
That's because I didn't know exactly what he
that's
said.
That's not
I just
right.
Know, yeah, I thought it was going to be much worse than your wife
they gave
in a burqa didn't speak.
Right, and it looked like she wasn't allowed to talk.
Yeah. Like probably wasn't.
He just said, and that's right, too. He just said what everybody was thinking. And... But they reacted as if he said, you know.
Yeah.
You know, right, exactly.
Your son's
Adrian, there's
here.
A lot of women in Coney Island. They lift up the burqa.
Coney Island has nothing to do with it.
I understand.
You just said a lot of women in Coney Island. So we were talking about Coney Island.
A lot of women wear burqas that are that religious.
Yeah, we get it. We know that.
But you got to see when they eat. Like they lift up the...
I've never seen it. I've never heard of it. Now that's the most offensive thing.
The drape.
Your poll numbers are going to drop.
That's all right.
Yeah, do you have it?
I'll blame it on Donald Trump.
Do you have that Trump thing?
Not yet, no.
Oh.
Give me like 3 minutes.
You're, okay, fine. You were looking at me like, yeah.
I'll give you 5.
What'd you have, carpal tunnel? So you know the story then.
Yes.
But that is how, you know, that took him down for some reason. That was the thing. And now everybody sees an opening. All his enemies see an opening now, and even the Republicans are just bailing. And so he's getting creamed, and now he's getting angrier. And
so, Adrian, you think that the public thought he was saying that he wasn't a hero because he?
I think he didn't say anything that wrong.
No. But you think people thought that he was implying that
because of how people spun it afterwards.
Right. Well, that's kind of like Bill Maher and what he said after 9/11.
Well, he really said that.
But yeah, he really said
it. What Maher said was, you know, verbatim what they said. He said they're actually making something up that Trump might have said. You know
that, yeah. But
what's the example you gave? Like what you just said is perfect.
Didn't he say something like didn't McCain or somebody fight in the war? And he's like, at least I didn't get
that
caught.
That was horrendous.
Right.
Like that's what's back.
I thought he said something like,
that's backwards.
Your son isn't a hero. He died.
Exactly.
Like I thought that's what he was going to say. But, not that your wife in a burqa said nothing.
But that's what's backwards about this. Right. That should have ended it.
Yes.
The McCain thing is way fucking worse.
Yeah.
He said, I like guys who don't get captured.
Right. That to me is a lot worse.
Doesn't even make any sense. Like what he was just thinking, what he said, what everybody else was thinking on the con thing. The fucking McCain thing, only an asshole thinks that way. Not everybody's thinking that. Just him.
No, right. I would have never thought that. Only.
But it's like you said, when you get mad and you have that brain, that's where it goes.
Well, the other part
it tries to win too hard.
The other part where you said is true too. I think at some point he thinks he's a comedian. He's getting laughs at the
rally. That's the thing. I think he is trying to make people laugh.
He is.
Who do we vote for?
That's a bad. That's a bad road to go down if you're trying to get elected. Because if you go for the laugh,
he's playing.
You go for the laugh and not the political point.
He's playing to the back of the room.
Way back. That's a perfect way to put it.
It's so fucked up that there's even times for a comedian where we shouldn't go for the
laugh. Oh, God, yeah.
Where we get in trouble.
Well, I can point to Joe Buck. That was actually a point where I was hired to be funny and I shouldn't have been funny.
Yeah, I've done it.
Yeah, but but now it's clear that his anger has taken over. And what he said today, and I think
that's way worse.
Oh, God, not even close. He's saying, look, shoot her.
Yeah.
But the thing is with Trump is where it can be confusing, and it happens as a comedian too, where there are people that like that you push the button.
Sure.
So he could be so crazy in his head that he's going, and when I go all the way fucking wrong, I gain votes.
But our consequences are nothing compared to what his are. I mean, we get, you know. Well, Dan, do you have it?
Yes.
Okay.
But what this if he is, thinks he's actually helping his cause by fucking bringing more psychos to his
that's
side?
That's where he's delusional. At,
yeah.
Because he's not. The poll numbers showed he's getting destroyed. Okay, this is me, 2004 on Stern. Trump comes in and talks. Now, this is the best. I've done a lot of these roasts, but I don't really consider myself great at this. And this is the best I ever did at a roast. The Daily News and the Post called me the best roaster there. That never happened to me with one of these. And this
was after they said you got canned from HBO.
This is before. This joke that I tell here was about Trump's finances. And
I would have been really impressed, Artie, by the way, if you would have said, Dan, can you pull up that clip of me bombing on that roast?
Well, it's not the roast, though.
Oh, this isn't the roast?
No.
Okay.
It's his reaction afterwards. It just shows how nuts he is. like I'm at the time, if I'm lucky, D-list celebrity, and he's mocking me. He can't get me out of his head. Go ahead, play it.
Stop it, Artie.
Artie did a great job at my roast, Howard. I'm telling you. He was the single best person. A lot of people thought you were totally bombed out of your mind.
He
was the
bombed.
Best. I'm telling you, we had all these comedians.
What did he say about you that really hurt?
I don't want to go into it. It was terrible.
What was your best joke?
He
go ahead.
Was the funniest.
Let me hear two of the jokes.
Well, one of the things, you know, there's talk about some Donald financial problems in Atlantic City. And I said that Donald took his daughter for a drive through Atlantic City and said, someday, honey, your name will be at the top of all these buildings. That's if you marry a guy named Borgata.
I had to bring
this
up.
That was a good one.
I had to bring this up. I'll tell you, honestly, the Atlantic City stuff is doing great.
No, I mean, my
All right.
He had to bring this crap up.
No, you brought it up.
I had to bring you up.
It was nice of you.
What did I bring you up for?
It was nice
I
of you.
I thought he was, you know, I was trying to be nice to him. The truth is, he was terrible at the time. It was terrible. He did a lousy job. But I tried to be
oh, my God.
And this is what happens. You get hit. This is like Dan Rather all over again.
No. Absolutely.
Loser. So now I don't talk to Artie anymore.
Oh, come on.
Get him.
Howard made me tell that joke.
All right. Now.
How crazy. Best ever. Loser.
you bombed.
No, that's right. Bombed, lose, and like loser, bye. And I'm like nothing. Like who cares? It's like he's arguing. He, like a third grader could bait him. And that's, you know, that's years ago when he didn't have all this shit. He's exactly that guy.
Well,
and he turns on a dime.
Yeah, people think it'd be funny for him to be president. And I guess it would, but... If you think about him actually being president, freaking out like that,
right.
You're just like, that's very scary.
I mean, what that showed there was like a turnaround in a millisecond, and he felt trapped, sort of like, you know, and he probably did say, "Oh, this loser is getting the best." but that mentality doesn't work because the relationship he has with Putin already. If Putin says his shoes are stupid.
He shouldn't even be allowed to be on Air Force One with the president, let alone be the president
on Air Force One. When you're a candidate, you get all the codes, right? What do you get access to?
You get briefed intelligence on. Briefings.
Really?
So they're worried to give him that because maybe he'll sell it.
Well, and his guy, Paul Manafort, his head guy, is getting paid by the Russian government to be their PR guy.
If they tried something like that, it would be treason. If they'd be in jail, they'd be executed. This would be the stupidest thing ever. But Hillary is so flawed as a candidate. If he could keep harping on that and get every blue-collar guy to vote for him, just make sure you don't piss off those Teamster guys. And I don't think he can. The guys I've talked to, there's nothing he can. This shit, they don't care. They'll vote for him. Because they think the other people are talking down to him, you know, and there's anger there.
He's got to tone down the tan sunburn face too.
You
I don't
really
know what
didn't
the
know about
going.
The con thing. Yeah. You really didn't
no, he,
know?
He said he knew about it.
Oh, okay.
Did you? My
but
friend.
But just got to know how it affected.
We should get him a pair of orange Crocs.
He's wearing one on his head.
I'm literally looking at him on your TV, and it looks like there's something wrong with your TV. Like the color's fucked up. Like whenever Trump's on, it's like his hair's orange, and then the side of his hair is white, and then his face is pink, and then he has white circles underneath each eye. It's just weird. Like it's fucking. No one else on the screen looks weird. Like the color's fine on everybody else.
Well, look at her dress.
Oh.
Hillary just, she's going to trip. Look at her. She's her grandmother.
My friend told me about an article where they said, like, the Clintons have had the most people commit suicide, like 45 people in their administration.
Well, because they killed them.
I thought you were going to say in their family.
No, but that is an extended family. They consider it your family.
Isn't that crazy?
No, it is. The Clintons are evil people.
They are.
They're probably more evil than Donald Trump.
Yeah, but then who do we vote if we don't go Trump or we don't go Clinton?
Matt, what a really unique question.
You came up with that?
All right. I got to go give Maneev this money. It's a long story. Okay, Dan, I want to play the latest. The listeners have been barraging us with a Dan Gay songs. And this one kid is obsessed with these rap songs, but he does a great job. Vinnie Monroy. What is this song? It's Dr. Dre?
Yes, the Still Dre.
Still Dre?
Right.
Okay, the reference is the kid must listen to the show over and over again because I forget the references. And it's just in the podcast, most of them Dan's Gay stuff. So listen to this. This is impressive to me. Vinnie Monroy.
Yeah, Artie. I'm still fucking with you. Still love Rick Steves.
That's Dan.
Still Danny and Artie Lang 2016, bitches.
Guess who's back?
You still doing that comedy, Artie?
Oh, yeah. Check it out. It's Artie Lang Day Quitter, AK Quitter. Though I've grown a lot, I stay at home a lot. Cause when I frequent the spots that I'm known to rock, crazy fans bug me and then they cock block. Quitters, they pay homage, but haters saying Artie fell off. How? Have you heard the fucking podcast? They wanna know if I still got it. Comedy has changed, they wanna know how I feel about it.
You ain't up on things.
Artie Lang is the name, I'm ahead of the game. Still eat posters, treats, still fuck with the tweets. Still hate female police. Still rock my cargoes with dirty sneaks. Still got love for the streets reppin' New Jersey.
I don't hate female police.
Still doing my thing since I left, ain't too much changed.
and representing for the quitters all across the world.
Still
fucking around with the millennial girls.
Still taking my time with the comedy, and I still got love for your tweets. It's the
and
RT.
Representing for the quitters all across the world.
Still
fucking around with the millennial girls.
Still taking my time with the comedy.
Is this the same guy? Like doing each voice?
Yes.
It's
yes.
The RT. Last time you heard from me, I lost a friend.
Hey, now.
Well, hell, me and Dan, we back again. Get my ears to the streets. Gonna sign Vinny. He's
who else is writing a rap about our relationship?
Still, I stay close to the
it's tweets. A unique subject.
And even when I was close to defeat, I rose to my feet. My life is like a buffet. I decide what to eat. Diabetic, so I can't feel my feet. Wake up in the
what the fuck?
Host a podcast. I bring the funny to you shitting in your pants. It's not a fluke. I
diabetic.
I'm the truth called Mario.
Not many rappers admit to being diabetic in their songs. It's not
I'm
cool.
Still at it. Inspire all addicts in the home of
Mario. Got to mention
attractive comedy seller. Good pizza, bad traffic. I dip through, then I get laughs.
I'm representing for the quitters all across.
I like this voice. Still, this voice is
fucking
great.
Fucking around with the millennial girls.
Still taking my time with the
and
comedy.
And the real song is that we're still sounding
for your tweets. It's the RT.
All right, sorry, it's just repetitive. Good job, Ben.
Good job, Benny. Woo!
It takes a lot of time. I mean, the guy's got serious writing. Like, he's trying with references. But in the real song, now I'm curious, is that, do you know that real song, Adrian?
I do know.
You're
the
song. The youngest.
I do know the song.
Oh, you do?
Does somebody sound like weird like that?
Like, yeah, does he sound like,
no.
No?
No. It's two different people, though.
That's unique.
Who sings it?
Vinny Monroy.
But who sings the...
Oh, Dr. Dre.
And, okay, but it's just
that's,
him.
Right, that's what it's
saying,
But
you
right?
said it's yeah. two guys. In the
yeah,
song.
I don't know.
It's Dre and someone else.
Dre and...
And Snoop, maybe?
Is it Snoop?
It might be Snoop, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Wow,
maybe it is.
That's heavy hitters. Snoop Dogg is so funny. He is just cashing in on it. He's doing a show with Martha Stewart right now. He just gets checks.
What is the show?
They live together. Like, you know, like in the, she cooks for him. And I mean, let's see what really would happen. Like a little mulatto action, if you know what I'm talking about.
No.
Let's see if he could win the mulatto. You know what? You know I don't know technology. There's commercials, and I don't know what they're for. And it's for some sort of like MR MP3 player thing, and I don't even know what it does. You know what I mean? But I know the commercial.
90% of it is all bullshit.
Thank you so much. All right, Mario, you got to plug anything?
Not this week.
All right, bye.
Thank you guys at the Borgata.
Oh, yeah, good job, Borgata. You get, I can't believe I'm paying you for that, but you'll get a check. Joe, you got, you know, did you get a check yet, by the way?
No. Okay. Should I have?
No, I'm just saying, how long does it usually take?
It depends what year.
Anyway.
What year we're talking
anyway,
about.
Anyway, good
what
job.
What year, Artie?
But Joe, good job as always.
Back in the day, 3 days after the gig, boom, check there.
Yeah,
no. But now, usually a week.
Different day.
Usually a week.
Different times, I think.
I need to get some people down to Somerville, Mass. This Saturday, I'm at the Davis Square Theater. If you go to joematteries.com, there's a promo code on there to get you 2-for-1 tickets. Go right there and come on out. It's Minutes from Boston. And subscribe to my new subscription podcast, Fix Joe Podcast, on joematteries.com also. Would love your subscriptions. My kids would really appreciate
the money. Well, cheer up, dude. I hope you're all right.
Yeah. Get off those Adderalls.
Well, I sold the special, and I do have that little
I'm glad about that
production deal for no money.
The special is good.
Happening.
The special is very good. Check it. Wait, the production is no money.
No money. That's how it works.
Welcome. You sold your special.
You
got
think
no
that
money
would? You think that would not depress? No, the special I got,
okay.
I get money for, but I have a deal with a production company now, and they have to try to attach a writer, and then if we sell it to a network, I get money, but I don't get any money just
Wait,
for them attaching to my idea.
So before you get money, you got to get the writer and attach it.
And then sell it to the network.
God, the
this
days.
Is it's not the old days. That the old days.
So basically, you just don't have a deal.
I had to hire an entertainment lawyer to figure out that no money contract.
I could have figured it out for you for free.
He gets 5% the entertainment.
Yeah, they always do that.
But if it makes nothing, he gets nothing. So at least I don't have to pay
Who
him.
Who's the 5% guy?
Who's my lawyer?
Yeah,
Chunk from the movie Goonies. He played Chunk. In Goonies.
Oh, I don't know that. Okay.
Do you know this guy?
He sounds great.
Jeff Cohen.
Oh, Jeff Cohen. Yeah, I do
know
Jeff.
Him?
I know Jeff
nice
Cohen.
Nice guy.
Yep, absolutely. Well, good luck. Man, the old days were they were giving away money.
At least the production company I have to deal with has 5 shows on the air right now. They're a good. They're a pretty big entity.
You had a UPN deal, if I remember back in the day.
I had a.
Did you?
I had a deal with Will Smith's production company,
right.
And then NBC was the second step. I got money right from the beginning on that one. That's how it worked back
then. Oh, we
did
with Cherry Hill Street Blues, right?
Jerry, that's a good name.
You had that.
See, we're making you smile.
Will Smith. Yeah, those were the days, man. David Tochterman. Remember that guy?
Oh, that's right. He was huge.
Yeah, he was the guy.
David Tochterman was the guy you wanted to get a meeting with.
Yeah, he got me the deal. He was the guy I had to deal with. He worked for Will Smith's production.
That's
but
right.
But before that, he was at, I think, ABC and did Brett Butler.
Yeah, no, David, that's
claim to fame.
David Tochterman was huge. And I got, you know what? I had a meeting with that guy. I pitched a Good Will Smith hunting.
Good Will Smith hunting.
Good Will Smith, yeah. And it was he's a janitor at All Black College. And the problem on the board is 2 + 2. It took our professors 5 years to figure this one out. All right, who's the genius? Who the genius who figured out it was 4?
Did you tell that tiger joke in the meeting?
No, but I might as well. I did the Amos and Andy voice I just did. Peter Principal said, when it bombed after 2, Good Will Smith, I think it bombed. 2 + 2, it bombed. Why'd you keep going? I said, we got to commit to the... I said, maybe they would have liked the, you know, maybe you never know. You turn around with the Amos and Andy thing.
Was Will Smith there?
No, thank God. But I got a feeling word got back to him. I feel I was snubbed by a party when I saw him. It took our professor. And then my next thing was Tori Amos and Andy, and I scrapped that. So now, Adrian, what do you got? What are you plugging, baby?
I'm going to be headlining the Beer Baron in D.C. on Friday.
Nice!
I don't know what it even is, but at least I'll say I did my part.
You're doing
your promoting it.
The Beer Baron.
Adrian's fearless, which is great. She's such a great comic, and she's fearless. She'll go into the fray. And look, keep paying your dues. Eventually, we'll all be in heaven going, ah, fuck it.
It was fun.
It's working for a living.
Adrian, real quick, tell the joke that you said that you shouldn't have told. I think we were opening for Artie when we were in Ridgefield, Connecticut.
Ooh,
which is
the school shooting joke?
10 minutes away from where the school shooting was.
What did you do? You've opened for me, by the way, you've always done well. I don't remember. But I think I remember.
Didn't realize till after we were so close to where
right.
the school
There might have been
was.
Victims in the audience.
There definitely was.
I remember leaving this. Was that the show I left and somebody was like, not funny?
Well, the best was I told her afterwards, I go, you didn't need to even say the name of the school. You didn't need to say the name of the school.
Yeah. I didn't say the name of the school. I just said that. Why would you want to?
You know
have-
that school your kids were killed at?
I just said school shootings. I didn't say whatever school they were shot
So what
at.
Was the joke?
As if
it needs more to be funny.
It's funny. But
something about why would you want to have kids?
Why
would you want to have kids? There's always a school shooting. If I had kids, I would just take matters into my own hands and be like, when you go to school, make friends with the most awkward kid in there. The kid sitting in the corner making no eye contact is your best friend.
And not the punchline's great.
And if he's
tell
like,
him to bring an extra gun.
That's not the point.
Don't fucking step in the joke like a bad radio DJ would.
That's awful.
What is the joke?
Now I can't do it. You just fucked it up.
No, I'm
with it.
He's like, well, what if I get made fun of? And I'm like, well, that's how you earn his trust. You want to be the cool kid in school, or you want to make it to graduation? There's more to it, but that's like the gist of it.
You see why you're not good? I'm kidding.
I thought it was something you won't have any friends, but you'll make it to graduation.
You won't be the cool.
Oh wait, that wasn't the cool, the good version.
I thought there was a slight different version.
Oh, I hate when a comic does what Joe's doing right now.
It's the worst.
That
is it. Sorry.
I said, do you want to be the cool kid in school, or you want to make it to graduation?
That's funny.
That's funny.
I don't know what he's
saying. And what did I say after the show that you didn't need that you could still do the joke without using
school shooting?
Well,
there's another part to the joke where I said like these kids are getting a lot of these shooters do it because girls wouldn't date them. And it's like, all right, ladies, I've seen the guys you're fucking. Take one for the team. I was like, I dated a guy with Asperger's for 2.5 years. Was that guy my first choice? No. And I'm like, but I had a responsibility.
Was he my second choice?
And I was like, but I had a responsibility to my community. Those 2.5 years, not one school shooting in my neighborhood.
Because he had Asperger?
I think you have like 30 jokes on dating the Asperger's guy.
That I think
are
that's
hilarious.
The only one I have that I keep, though.
You know, I have a couple dating Asperger's girls. We should put them together. I have one dating Prada Willy girls where they don't have the gene that tells them they're full. Prada Willy Mays. All right, well, thank you. We're due for a gig. We got to do a gig together.
Aren't we opening up for you and Caroline's?
Are we?
Yeah, remember I asked you?
Oh, you did? Yeah. Okay.
You said he's going to...
Just show up.
No, I'm not going to.
Are you working at Caroline's?
Let's just pretend that you guys are stopping by my show Saturday night. It'll help me sell tickets. But don't show up.
I'll come. Edit this in. I can't wait to do a set at Joe's thing in Somerville.
In Boston.
And my show, too.
Yeah,
he's coming
show.
To both.
And Adrian, I'll come to both.
Artie's going
to
be.
Now, when is the Caroline's gig? Do you know?
Yes, the 15th.
In September.
September 15th.
How do you know?
17.
Remember I said, can I open for you? And you said, Joe is opening for me. And then you said,
are
well,
you?
Will you let him
Did I
host?
Ask you to open for me, Caroline's?
Oh, my God. I have it on my phone.
I don't know.
I believe you. You're in.
I was going to ask you, too.
No.
You might have asked me, and I might have had something booked. I don't have my calendar in front of me. But you might have asked me a while ago.
So, yeah, I definitely asked my calendar, but it was a different date. They switched dates.
Oh.
All right. Well, yeah, you're definitely in. September 15th, then. We should put the, is that what it is?
15, 16, 17.
If you want to come by, come by. I can't guarantee it.
Come by.
Take care. Brush your hair, guys. Thanks, guys, for coming.
Thanks.